good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
It's a beautiful fall morning. Just can't ask for more sunshine than this. It's lovely. Now, this morning, our entrance hymn is 397, Praise the One Who Breaks the Darkness. If you would all stand. Of the Lord.
Praise and exalt the Holy One forever.
Bless the Lord, you angels of the Lord.
Praise and exalt the Holy One forever.
O people of God, bless the Lord.
Praise and exalt the Holy One forever.
Bless the Holy and Undivided Trinity, one God.
Praise and exalt the Holy One forever.
Now we'll pray now the Kyrie together. God be gracious to us and bless us. Make your face shine upon us.
Kyrie.
Kyrie.
May your ways be known on the earth and your saving power among the nations.
Kyrie.
Kyrie.
Make known your salvation and reveal your justice in the sight of the nations.
Kyrie.
Together, may the God of love and power forgive us and free us from our sins, strengthen us by the Spirit, and raise us to new life in Christ our Lord. Amen. And we pray together the collect today, the special prayer of the day. Let us pray. Lord of the feast,
you have prepared a table before all peoples and poured out your life with abundance. Call us again to your banquet. Strengthen us by what is honorable, just, and pure, and transform us into a people of righteousness and peace through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Please be seated for the Word of God. Yes.
26, 1923. Give thanks to the Holy One who is good, for God's mercy endures forever.
Who can declare the mighty acts of our God, or show forth all God's praise?
Happy are those who act with justice and always do what is right.
Remember me, O God, with the favor you have for your people, and visit me with your saving help.
That I may see the prosperity of your elect and be glad with the gladness of your people, that I may glory with your inheritance.
We have sinned as our forebears did. We have done wrong and dealt wickedly.
Israel made a bull calf at Horeb and worshipped a molten image.
And so they exchanged their glory for the image of an ox that feeds on grass.
They forgot God, their Savior, who had done great things in Egypt.
Wonderful deeds in the land of Ham, and fearful things at the Red Sea.
So you would have destroyed them had not Moses, your chosen, stood before you in the breach and turned away your wrath from consuming them.
Glory to God, our Creator, to God's most holy word, and to the Spirit indwelling, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
Childhood, you have known the sacred writings that are able to instruct you for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. All scripture is inspired by God and is useful for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, so that everyone who belongs to God may be proficient, equipped for every good work. In the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who is to judge the living and the dead, in view of his appearing and his kingdom, I solemnly urge you, proclaim the message, be persistent whether the time is favorable or unfavorable, convince, rebuke, and encourage with the utmost patience in teaching. For the time is coming when people will not put up with sound doctrine, but having itching ears, they will accumulate for themselves teachers to suit their own desires, and will turn away from listening to the truth and wander away to myths. As for you, always be sober, endure suffering, do the work of an evangelist, carry out your ministry fully. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand as you are able to sing our gospel affirmation.
City, there was a widow who kept coming to him saying, "Grant me justice against my opponent." For a while he refused, but later he said to himself, "Though I have no fear of God and no respect for anyone, yet because this widow keeps bothering me, I will grant her justice so that she may not wear me out by continually coming." And the Lord said, "Listen to what the unjust judge says. And will not God grant justice to his chosen ones who cry to him day and night? Will he delay long in helping them? I tell you, he will quickly grant justice to them, and yet, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on earth? Gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Please be seated. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. We are an impatient bunch living here now in the 21st century. I think our pervasive technology has done that to us. We want everything now, and we are astounded when we can't have it. I would wager that there is hardly anything you could name that couldn't be delivered possibly by tomorrow. Not only are we impatient, but we are also easily distracted. There is so much that pulls us away from our tasks at hand. The lure of hundreds of television channels, the appeal of the internet, the delusions of constant marketing, and the tricks of jealousy and greed. It's a wonder that we can stay focused on anything sometimes, or that we can achieve what we have set out to do. Our gospel reading today from Luke, the parable of the persistent widow, has much to instruct us on these realities. Here in Luke, we find Jesus approaching Jerusalem. His ministry will soon come to an end. The end of time, the full flowering of God's kingdom is on his mind. And he wonders, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on earth? The story of the persistent widow and the unjust judge may provide some clues. Widows are prominent throughout the Bible and are often portrayed as deserving of respect. Think of Ruth, Naomi, and Anna, whose initiative and resourcefulness were legendary. Widowhood is often perilous. It was true in the time of Jesus, and in fact, it is true now. Statistics Canada reports that 5 years after widowhood, the median family income declines by almost 10% for widows. Not only does their standard of living decline, but more widows also fall below the low-income threshold as a result of widowhood. 5 years after widowhood, 9.4% of widows live in a low-income situation. So the persistent widow, who cannot be ignored by the unjust judge, should not be ignored by us either. Indeed, despite her unenviable situation, she has persistently petitioned the judge, who represents to us all a persistent faith, persistent hope, persistent prayer. This is the kind of faith on earth that Jesus hopes he will find. And what can we say about the unjust judge, who neither fears God nor respects God's children, initially refusing to grant justice to the widow? But she persists and persists and persists and persists until at last the judge agrees, if only to get her off his case, and indeed to avoid getting beat up. Interestingly, the New Revised Standard Translation of the Bible, which we most often use, obscures the almost slapstick tone of the original Greek. Translated literally, the judge says, "Because the widow causes trouble for me, I will give her justice so that she may not in the end give me a black eye by her coming." Importantly, as one commentator writes, in effect, Jesus is saying, if even an unjust judge eventually gives in to a persistent request for justice by a woman he neither loves nor respects, how much more will God, the consistently just judge, grant justice to God's beloved? So take heart. God cannot and does not grant every justice for which God is petitioned by the beloved. We do not receive justice without patience and persistence. Yet Jesus is acknowledging here that God's kingdom of justice hasn't arrived yet for God's beloved, and he's urging them to remain active, faithful, and courageous in the meantime. No matter how long it takes, he says, keep calling on God for justice. Keep demanding it like the tireless, tenacious widow. And keep trusting that in the end, justice will be done. This way, when the Son of Man comes, there will be faith on earth. This faith on earth, boldness, persistent, even the odd threat of a black eye, and this is very much about prayer. Not a quiet, hushed endeavor of solitude, but a bold, persistent lamentation where your feet are anchored to the ground in a stance that you will not easily give up. Indeed, a full half of the Book of Psalms are prayers of lament. The Psalter is the tenacious widow's prayer book, and it should be ours too. Despite the many injustices of this world, and we all know them all too well, Jesus is saying, the child of humanity will come. God's realm of justice and love will indeed arrive in the end, and your faith shall not be in vain, so take heart. Follow the tenacious widow's lead, praying without ceasing, lamenting when necessary, insisting on justice, and trusting that it's on the way. We have all experienced times in our lives when tenacity is likely all we have. Ask anyone who has raised a child, if that is not a leap of faith, I don't know what is. Many things we do are undertaken with only hope and prayer. Education, for example, my students used to say to me, is university hard? And I would always answer, it's not so much that it is hard as it is an endurance test. Post-secondary education, something that these days takes 5 or 6 years and costs a significant amount of money, leaves a student with no guarantee of anything in the end. We prefer instant satisfaction and immediately measurable results. As I was writing this sermon, I kept hearing in my mind the gospel song of the American Civil Rights Movement, We Shall Overcome. The hymn was written by Charles Albert Tindley and published in 1901. One verse proclaims, the Lord will see us through, the Lord will see us through, the Lord will see us through someday. Oh, deep in my heart, I do believe we shall overcome someday. Deep in our hearts, we believe, like the persistent widow, that our work will be rewarded and justice will be served. So what can we learn from the persistent widow? Firstly, don't give up. Easier said than done, to be sure, especially during the dark days through which we all sometimes struggle. Keep putting one foot in front of the other. With your faith, you are on the right path, even though it may not always seem so. Secondly, God hears our prayers. Even though justice may seem remote, it will come to us all. And thirdly, it is through living our faith, even when we seem surrounded by obstacles, that persistence itself becomes witness to the gospel. I'll say that again. Persistence itself becomes witness to the gospel. Indeed, that faith, that persistence, stands in stark contrast, bold resistance, active protest to the injustices of the world. This is our line in the sand, our statement of truth, hope, and love. God's justice will prevail, and there will be faith on earth. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Martha, for those words of encouragement in our faith and a reminder that God gets the last word. So as you are able, please stand as we affirm our faith, that very faith. Let us affirm our faith in God.
We long for you, O God. We confess our deep desire for the heavens are arrayed with your unhidden beauty. You are the source of our yearning, O Christ. You are the way of glory, bearing our sweet and humble flesh, fruit of a woman's womb. You were made and molded as we are. Spirit of discernment, integrity, and fire, breathe on our fearlessness, refine our truthfulness, and sing through our speechlessness, so that we may daily refuse what is evil and be taken up with grace. Merciful Creator of an infinite tenderness, wounded Redeemer, by whom all flesh is moved, Comforter of fire, who leads us into truth, we offer you our praise. Amen.
Please sit, stand, or kneel, as is your custom for the prayers of the people.
Today is the 19th Sunday after Pentecost, in year C of the Ordinary Common Lectionary, common whatever it is. This morning, we have all woken up here in New Westminster and in several other municipalities to a new set of mayors and councillors and school trustees, so I would like to call upon God's guidance to these people as they, for the next 3 years, guide our city and Vancouver and Surrey and other municipalities, and ask you all to ask for God's blessing and guidance for them. God alone is our help. We lift up our needs and the needs of the whole human family, saying, Lord, have mercy. For those who lead the people of God, that they may seek after integrity and be true to their call to service, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For Christians everywhere, that we may be rich in good works and generously share what we have, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
That our eyes may be open to see poverty and human need, and that seeing, we may act justly, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
That our young people may learn to love charity, justice, and a gentle spirit, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the aged, the infirm, the lonely, the homeless, and for all who need help to live with dignity, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
That those who are imprisoned for the sake of the gospel may bear bold and glad witness to the Lord, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
I'll call your attention to page 4 of the bulletin for the Anglican Worldwide Cycle of Prayer, the Diocesan Cycle of Prayer, the St. Barnabas Cycle of Prayer, and for strength and healing for Liz, Wayne, Lauren, Peter, and Carol. Giver of all life, we ask you to sustain our life and the life of the world. Hear our cries for help. Make us as generous as you are in answering those who turn to you. We ask this in the name of Jesus, the Lord. Amen.
May the peace of Christ be always with you.
And also with you.
Please offer a sign of peace to your neighbors safely.
Thank you.
Holy God,
gracious and merciful,
you bring forth food from the earth and nourish your whole creation. Turn our hearts towards those who hunger in any way, so that all may know your care, and prepare us now to feast on the bread of life. Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. We'll be using Eucharistic prayer number 2, found on page 196. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
We give you thanks and praise, Almighty God, through your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Redeemer. He is your living Word. Through him you have created all things. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he took flesh of the Virgin Mary and shared our human nature. He lived and died as one of us to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. In fulfillment of your will, he stretched out his hands in suffering to bring release to those who place their hope in you. And so he won for you a holy people. He chose to bear our griefs and sorrows and to give up his life on the cross, that he might shatter the chains of evil and death, and banish the darkness of sin and despair, and by his resurrection he brings us into the light of your presence. Now with all creation we raise our voices to proclaim the glory of your name. In the same way he took the cup, saying, "This is my blood which is shed for you. When you do this in memory of me." Remembering therefore his death and resurrection, we offer you this bread and this cup, giving thanks that you have made us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. We ask you to send your Holy Spirit upon the offering of your Holy Church. Gather into all those who share in these sacred mysteries, filling them with the Holy Spirit and confirming their faith in the truth, that together we may praise you, give you glory through your Son, through your servant Jesus Christ. All glory and honor are yours, Father and Son, with the Holy Spirit in the Holy Church. Amen. Now we will pray the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial. And deliver using fraction number one. I am the bread of life, says the Lord. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry. Whoever believes in me will never thirst. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Happy are they who trust in him. These are the gifts of God for you, the holy people of God.
Thanks
be to God. Please stand as you are able for the prayer after communion. O God, we give you thanks that you have set before us this feast, the body and blood of your Son. By your Spirit, strengthen us to serve all in need and to give ourselves away as bread for the hungry. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Glory to God,
whose power within us can do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine. Glory to God, from generation to generation, in the church and in Christ Jesus, forever and ever. Amen.
Are there any community announcements? No?
I can't think of anything.
Well, I want you to also keep in your prayers all those who volunteered in this election, all those who came out to vote, and we exercised our democracy, and all those who lost. And I'd like you to keep in prayer also Emily and Patty on their travels and on their acts of justice and on their beautiful music making.
And I tell you, it was an amazing, amazing.
And music. Jeanette is with us, so I'm sure we'll hear more of it at coffee time. Thank you. And now, our sending hymn, Now Thank We All of Them, number 399. Blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and all those you love this day and forevermore. Amen.
And now go forth in peace and love and tenacity, praising and sharing in the power of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen.
Thanks be to God.
And there's coffee.